And then once we have the user number, we can now call our get sum of digits in the user number, right? We can call that function. Now that function, we designed it in such a way that it needs the user number. And we have the user number right here. So we can pass that value, or that value as an argument, to the get sum of digits in user number function. Now our get sum of digits in user number function, we know returns the sum of digits in the user number. So when it's returning that number, which is the sum of digits in the user number, we need a place to store that as well. I'm going to create a variable to store the sum of digits in the user number. I'm going to call it that same name, sum of digits in the user number. I'm going to actually use the same name. It's okay to use the same name. This variable, the scope of this variable, is within the get sum of digits in user number function. Okay, this variable is only seen here in this function. The scope of the sum of digits in user number is within the main function. It's only seen here. They don't see each other at all. Okay, they are like twins, but they are not the same. Okay, they are considered different variables because they are in different functions. So you can use the same name because this is only visible here. This is only visible here. So now we have the sum of digits in the user number. Now we can go ahead and display it. I can call a print function and say that let's just display image, just saying the sum of all the digit in what the user typed. We have that value. What the user typed is user number. So I'm going to pass it as an argument. So the sum of all the digits in this number here, and then I can continue passing in another argument as a string and say is. And then I can display the sum, which we have here, a sum of digits in the user number. Okay, so the sum of all the digits in user number is this. Now, I'm passing in four different arguments into the print function, separating them with commas. When you pass arguments into the print function this way, separating them with commas, by default, when they are displayed with a space separating them. Okay, a space is separating each argument when they are printed. By default. All right, one more thing. You can see that I'm exceeding this line over here. This line is like a guideline for me not to exceed about 79 characters on a line. So it's a Python standard not to exceed around 79 characters on a line, and I want to follow that. And so because I'm exceeding this line, I know I'm exceeding 79 characters on a line, I want to break this line somewhere around here. And before you break the line, you type in a backslash and you hit enter. So now I've broken the line into two. This doesn't mess up this line of code. It's just a visual thing. It's just visual, okay? It doesn't have an effect on the line itself. The line is still one line. It still works. It's just visually I've broken onto another line, and I'm not exceeding this, and I'm following the standards. All right, so I think we're done. We have a function, the main function that's calling this function. When you run your program now, nothing is going to happen. So let's just run it and see. I'm going to save it where we normally save our programs, so desktop. I'm going to go to Python Program Challenges Chapter 8. This is our second program. I'm going to create a new folder for this. I'm going to call it sum of digits in a string. And then I'm going to save this file as sum of digit in a string.py. Save it. Now nothing happens. Why? Because we've only created or defined functions. That's all we've done, right? In order to have something happen, we need to call them. Now, even though in the main function we are calling the get sum of digits in the user number function, the main function is the function itself, and we need to call that as well. So I'm going to call the main function so that we can, basically run the code in the main function. So when I run this program, now it says, please enter a series of single digit numbers. I'm going to type in 2514. So 2514, and then hit enter. And now it says the sum of all the digits in 2514 is 12, which is correct. That's what the program said. Let's test something else. I'm going to type in, let's say, 23431. Hit enter, and says the sum of all the digits in 23431 is 13. We can see 2 plus 3 is 5, right? 5 plus 4 is 9, right? 9 plus 3 is 12, and 12 plus 1 is 13. Let's try one more time just to make sure. Random, just types in random numbers. Oops, no, just numbers here. So, just numbers here. Just too much, Let's just do something like that. And we can see it says the sum of all the digits in, 2982 is 21, right? So we can see it's correct. This is 11, right? And then this is 19, and then this is 2021, right? So we can tell that's working. So we're really done. But I also wanted to talk about I mentioned that normally when I go through a sequence, I like to use indexing because it just gives you a little bit more control. This will certainly work, but normally I like to use indexing. So I'm going to show you another way to go through this using indexing. So I'm going to just keep this return, right? Because return statement, I'm just going to comment this out. You still have access to both. So I'm just going to comment it. I'm going to type in command semicolon to comment this out. And I'm going to create another loop using indexing, okay, to go through this value here. So I'm going to create a target variable. So for a for loop and create a target variable. This target variable is going to represent the index of each element, or each digit as we are iterating through the loop. I'm going to call it, so for current digit index, okay, as string, okay. Hold on a second. Never mind. It's not going to be a string. This is just going to be the index, right? So for current digit index, forget about it. No, not a string. So for current digit index, this is just going to be the index used to access a particular character, okay, in the string. So for current digit index in range, and I'm going to type in the length of the user number. Okay, so if the length of the user number is, let's say, in this case, let's say if the user typed in 2514, it will be 4, right? I'm just going to type in 4 here. The range function is going to create a range from 0 all the way to 3. This number 4 here is not included in the range. It's marking the end of the range. It's like the ending limit, but it's not included in the range. So when you type in 4, it will create a range from 0 to 3. When you type in 9, it will create a range from 0 to 8. When you type in 3, it will create a range from 0 to 2. That value here is like the ending limit is not included in the range. So it will be 4 for this example, because you have 1, 2, 3, 4. That's the length of this value, whatever it is, the type, okay, the length of it. So if it's 4, what will happen is these numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, the numbers from 0 to 3 will be assigned to the current digit index. The first time this loop iterates, 0 will be assigned to current digit index. The next time it iterates, 1 will be assigned to current digit index. The next time it iterates, 2 will be assigned to it. And the next time it iterates, 3 will be assigned to it. And that's it. Again, 4 won't be included in the range. Okay? And this variable, okay, the value stored in here will represent the indices or the indexes that we are going to use to represent or target each character or each single digit in that string. You can do that. So instead of typing a 4, I'm going to use whatever the length of the user number is, right? Because the user number can type in a string that is like 10 characters or 10 digits long. So we need to make it dynamic. So the range is going to be whatever the length of this user number is. Okay? And so, okay, the value, the numbers will be assigned, the indices, okay, the numbers will be assigned to this variable, which will represent the indices. So what we want to do is each time we want to take that value. We know that to access that value, it will be a string. We know that. And so let's first access the current value. So that current value, in order to access it, you need to refer to the user number itself. Okay? And I'm going to use square brackets to access that current value. And the current value, you can access it with the current digit index. This is the current value. Now we know that this value here is a string, right? We know that. And so this is going to be the current digit as a string, right? So I'm going to create a variable to store that. So current digit as a string is going to be this value here, the current value we have here. We're accessing it, it's going to be a string. And then now we can go ahead and convert that value to an int, because we need it as an int in order to start accumulating it in sum of digits in the user number. And so I'm going to call the int function, pass in the current digit as a string to this. And then the int function is going to convert this value to an int. And so when it's done, it's going to return that value. We need a place to store it. That value that's being returned is the current digit as an int. So I'm going to create a variable called current digit as an int. that's going to receive this value that's coming, which is basically going to be the current digit as a string converted to an integer. This value is going to be an integer. Now when we have an int, we can start accumulating it. We can start adding it up to sum of digits in the user number. So sum of digits in the user number is going to be equal to what's already stored in sum of digits in the user number, okay, plus the current digit as an int, right? Now we are back to where we were, right here. So that's it. By the time this loop is done, we'll have all the numbers added up here in sum of digits in the user number. So outside of this loop, when it's done, we return the sum of digits in the user number. So this is the way you can use index. You can use indexing to access the elements this way as well. This is using the in operator to access the element. So you can choose which one you're comfortable with. Normally, I like to use indexing because it gives you more control generally when you're working with lists and other sequences. So let's try this first to make sure it works. So when I run this program, please enter a series of single digit numbers. Let's try what the question said, which is 2514. Hit enter, and it still works. It says the sum of all the digits in 2514 is 12. Let's try again. Let's try random numbers. Hit enter. It says the sum of all the digits in this is 25. So 29 we know is 11. We know 11 plus 3 is 14. We know this is 21, and then 21 plus 4 is 25. So it works. So you choose what you're comfortable with. Normally I like to use indexing, so I would normally use something like this. But I also, in programs, I've written so many programs where I use this as well. They're all very neat and handy. So I'm going to comment this out and maybe type in a command semicolon. And then you can uncomment this by highlighting it and then command semicolon as well, just to leave that. So you can use whichever one you want. Just don't have both. I mean, it'll still work if you have both. It's just going to get a sum of digits in a string. And let's see over here. Actually, it won't work. If you use both, it will keep accumulating. So you'd have double the amount. You'd have double. So don't use both, right? Because it'll get the sum, and it'll come here, and it'll keep on adding to the sum. So just use one structure. All right, so we are done. So if you have any questions, please comment down below, as always, and I'll do everything to respond to them. Thank you very much for watching. Take care of yourselves. Have a good night. Have a good sleep. Have a nice time. Have a good day, wherever you are. And I'll see you next time with the next video. All right, then. Bye-bye.